Good day, brothers and sisters in the Lord. How are we today? God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Now the question is, are you ready to worship and lift up the name of the living God? And if you are ready, you can stand from where you are. Let's just shout for joy. And this is not just an ordinary Sunday. Because every day, the Lord has been so good. And we're going to sing His goodness. We're going to sing His greatness. And we're going to lift His name. For He deserves the glory, honor, and praises that we could ever give to Him. Come on. Through You, everything is possible. And we're going to shout it out. Come on. I can do anything, I can do all things, 'cause it's You who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible through You. Blind eyes are open, strongholds are broken. I am living by faith. Not gonna live by what I see. I'm not gonna live by what I feel. Deep down, I know that You're here with me. I know that You can do anything. Through You, I can do anything.
I can do.
benevolence. We believe that that's who you are. We are your children and you are our Father. And if there's one thing that we have to believe in, that is your love for us. Unchanging, unstoppable, unmeasurable, goes beyond the wildest imagination. And today, we just want to sing our hearts out.
Concert through this.
ever give you. With all our heart, Lord, we pray for your speaker that you would speak through and by him. In Christ's name we declare, amen.
Pleasant day to everyone. I am so glad that you again joined us in this online worship service. And it is my prayer and desire that the Spirit of God would continue to speak into our hearts and minds, that we will be strengthened as we delve in and learn from the Word of the Lord this Sunday. Shall we open our Bibles in the book of Mark chapter 6? Mark chapter 6 verses 45 up to 52. Mark chapter 6, verses 45 up to 52. I will read from the New American Standard Bible. It says here, "Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he himself was sending the crowd away. After bidding them farewell, he left for the mountain to pray. When it was evening, the boat was in the middle of the sea, and he was alone on the land. Seeing them straining at the oars, for the wind was against them, at about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea, and he intended to pass by them. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed that it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke with them and said to them, 'Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid.' Then he got into the boat with them, and the wind stopped, and they were utterly astonished, for they had not gained any insight from the incident of the loaves, but their heart was hardened. May the good Lord bless the reading of his word. There was one time that we had gone through a day filled with activities in the church. And so we started the activities early in the morning until noontime in the afternoon, and then we left going back home late in the afternoon already, early in the evening. When we arrived home, I felt so exhausted. I was very tired. But when we arrived home, our two little children ran to me and said, 'Daddy, Daddy,' and they started hugging me, and then I saw in their eyes the desire to play with me, to enjoy my presence. But you know what? That time, I was very tired. I was exhausted. And then what happened next was I told them, 'Please leave Daddy alone. I want to take some rest.' The only thing that I had in my mind that time was to take a rest, to lie down. I know and believe you experience a similar situation like that when you are so tired, you are exhausted, and then the only thing that you thought of is finding some rest. The disciples of Jesus, I believe, felt the same. During this time, in the text that we read, it tells us that they already had some time with the crowd. But I want us to see the bigger picture of this situation. Because earlier in this narrative, you know what happened? Jesus sent the disciples for an actual ministry. And so they went out, they preached the gospel, they preached the word of God. And then after preaching, they didn't only share the good news to the people, but they also healed the sick. They drove out demons. And those were the experiences that they had. And I tell you, I experienced being called because there was a demon-possessed person. It is very, very exhausting. There was even a time that we had to deal with a demon possessed for 2 hours, and it was very exhausting. And so I can feel the experience of the disciples back then. And when they had all experienced this exposure, they went back to Jesus and they reported to him. And you know what? Jesus told them, "Let's get some rest. Let's take a retreat." That must be a very wonderful message from their master when they came back so tired, exhausted, from their journey or from their ministry whole day. And Jesus told them, "Let's have some rest. Let's take some retreat." And so they left already. The problem was, the crowd saw them And during this time, Jesus was already popular. People knew him as somebody who can heal sicknesses. People knew him as somebody who performed miracles. And so when they saw Jesus with the other disciples walking, they were trying to move away from the crowd because they thought of having a rest and a retreat. The crowd saw them and they followed them. And when they caught them, when the crowd caught Jesus with the disciples, they were there already and the Lord was with his followers. And Jesus looked at the crowd, looked at the people. And you know what Jesus said to his disciples? Feed them. Well, there is no problem when you are asked to feed two people. When you will be asked to provide for 10 individuals, probably would begin thinking, oh, ang dami nila, sampo. But this time, the disciples were asked to feed 5,000 people. And the disciples did not have that much. Their resources were not enough to feed this number of people. That is why they told Jesus, let's just send them away. Let's just send them home so that they can eat in the respective homes. But Jesus was feeling compassion towards the crowd. And Jesus told his disciples, let's feed them. And the Lord provided for the food. He multiplied whatever was in their hands. And then he asked his disciples to distribute this to the crowd. I want you to imagine this. The disciples went for an exposure. They were so tired preaching the word, healing the sick, and even driving out demons. They were so tired out of that experiences. And the only thing that they desired during that time was rest and retreat. But the crowd followed them. And here comes another activity. Not just activity, but a very tiresome activity. I tell you, every time we hold our Thanksgiving celebration here in Zamboanga City Alliance Evangelical Church, we gather around 4,000 to 4,500 people. We plan ahead of time about the scheme on how we are going to provide for them. We order food ahead of time. The only thing that we need to do during that day is go through the program, worship the Lord together, and then distribute the food packs. That's what we do here during Thanksgiving Day. We serve to around 4,000 to 4,500 people. And you know what? It's chaotic. Yes, we provide order, and every year we improve on that. But it is not easy to feed that many of a people of a mouth. It's so hard. And the disciples had that kind of experience because this time they did not even have a plan. Jesus just told them, we will feed these thousands of people. And so it went on and they fed these individuals. So imagine that they were tired already from a whole day of ministry exposure. And then after which they were exposed again to another ministry, which is feeding of the 5,000. And the text tells us that there were only 5,000 men, and most likely if there were women and children, there were even more than that number. And so the disciples fed them. They must be very, very tired already, exhausted already. And the very thing that they had desired right at that moment, I believe, was we really wanted to have that rest that you have mentioned earlier. We want to have a retreat. And then in verse 45, Jesus granted that desire. Look at verse 45. Immediately after feeding the 5,000, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side, to Bethsaida. Here comes the advice of the Lord. Go there, go ahead of me, and then you'll have your rest and your retreat. And then after saying that, Jesus stayed and bid farewell to the people. He said goodbye to the crowd. And I believe saying goodbye to 5,000 men won't happen in just 2 minutes. It will take some time. You know, every after worship service here in our church, the pulpit, the distance from the pulpit here in from this podium where I preach, going to my office, I think it's just around 100 steps. But it takes me sometimes an hour from here going there. Jesus, the time was saying goodbye to 5,000 people. Saying goodbye to this number of individuals would take many minutes, I believe. And so it happened. The disciples left already. Probably it was late in the afternoon. They left already that side of the lake, and then they went to the other side of Bethsaida. They were traveling. They were already sailing, going to the other side. Jesus stayed there and said farewell to the people, and then after which he left for the mountain to pray. Now, I was wondering here in the passage, because when you look at verse 37, right away it says, when it was evening, so most likely, that time when Jesus told them, you go to the other side, it was already late in the afternoon or early in that evening. That is why in verse 37, it started with, 47, it started with a line saying, when it was evening, the boat was in the middle of the sea. And added to that is this, what is this detail that was provided to us by the writer. It says there, and he was alone on the land, seeing them straining at the oars, for the wind was against them at about the fourth watch of the night. Now, if you look at a Roman time, a fourth watch, if you convert that in our time equivalent today, it is not 4 o'clock, but between 3 o'clock in the morning, dawn, to 6 o'clock in the morning. Now, this makes me wonder so much. If it was early in the or late in the afternoon that Jesus sent his disciples to the other side, how much time would it take for them to reach that side from where they were? If you look at the Lake of Galilee, it's not very vast. You can reach to the other side in a matter of an hour or two or three. That's the most probably. But why did it take them so much time? Now listen to this. As I delve into the text and observe the details that were written here by Mark, Jesus said farewell to the crowd, and while Jesus was telling this to the crowd, bye-bye, they were already on their boat sailing to the other side. Let's put it this way. Jesus took, it took him about 30 to 40 minutes saying goodbye to the crowd. So the disciples must be somewhere in the middle of the sea or the lake already when Jesus finished saying goodbye to the crowd. And then after which he proceeded going to the mountain to pray by himself. So he was there praying. I don't believe that Jesus would pray the way we do today, that it would only take a couple of minutes and then we're done. It takes him hours, I believe, when he prays. Di kagaya sa atin ngayon, pag magpa-pray tayo, Lord, thank you for this, and I acknowledge that you are like this, and then I ask these things before you, and I believe you'll give this to me. And then we say, Amen. We don't even reach sometimes 5 minutes in our prayer. But Jesus prayed for ours, I believe. And so if after saying goodbye to the crowd, the disciples were already somewhere in the middle of the lake, and then Jesus went to the mountain to pray. After his prayer, after hours of prayer, I believe his disciples already reached the other side. And then they were there already, but this is one of the most frustrating situations that the disciples had experienced. They were there already. They were bearing or they were holding on to the statement of their master who said, you go ahead to the other side and I'll follow you there. But they were there already. They rested and they waited. But I find it so difficult to rest when you are waiting for someone. If you are waiting for someone, balisa ka pa rin na hindi pa siya dumadating. Parents, I know you would agree with me. If your son is still outside of your house and you texted him early in the evening, you said, where are you, son? Around 7 o'clock. And your son told you that I am still here studying with my classmates. And so you took a rest, you lie down on your bed, you wanted to sleep already because you were so tired of your exhausting activities within the day. But you look at your watch and it was already 11 in the evening. And your son did not arrive yet. Do you think you would be able to rest? I don't think so. Your mind would be bothered. You will be waiting. You will be expecting the person to arrive as a grid. And so the disciples were there on the other side already. They were so tired from their ministry exposure, preaching the gospel, healing the sick, driving out demons, and then after which, instead of having a rest, they were exposed to the feeding of the 5,000. And they had to sail from this side to the other side of Bethsaida. And when they were there, they wanted to rest, but they could not rest because they were waiting for their master. But the master wasn't there still. For hours they waited. And what happened next was the disciples decided to go back. And so they decided to go back. The problem during this time was the wind was against them. And the text tells us that Jesus saw them. During the fourth watch of the night, they were in the middle of the lake. Now listen to this. I am not a fisherman. But I believe when you are using a boat that is operated through a sail and you are going against the wind, it would be very exhausting. It would be very difficult. Now, I want you to feel what the disciples felt that time. They were tired and exhausted from the whole day of ministry exposure. They were so tired from the feeding of the 5,000. They were frustrated from waiting for their master on the other side, and yet the master did not arrive yet. And now they are there in the middle of the lake. They were trying their best to sail against the wind so that they could go back and find out what happened to their master. Added to that is this detail in the narrative. When that happened, you know what? Jesus went to them and he walked on the sea and he intended to pass by them. He came to them and what happened? But when they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed that it was a ghost. I have never seen a ghost in my whole life. If there is a fallen angel that would show himself to me, I don't know what I would feel. Though I believe that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I believe that my God is more powerful, but I couldn't just imagine a person who is so exhausted, who is so frustrated already, who is so physically fatigued already, so tired from the day's activity, now seeing a ghost. I couldn't imagine what they felt that time. Ambotlag unsay imong isagit og makakita kag multo. But that's how they perceived Jesus walking on water. They were so tired, they were exhausted, they were anxious, they were worried, they were frustrated. And yet listen to this. In the midst of that physical tiredness, in the midst of their frustration and anxiety, in the midst of that worry, in the midst of that situation where they were in the midst of that struggle, the master introduced himself to them and he said this line to his disciples. Listen to this. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. Now, I believe this is very important. And the way I look at this statement, it is so significant. Because I observe a chiastic structure in this statement of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at this statement. Take courage. He said, take courage. And in the last part of his statement, he said, do not be afraid. Now, I want you to take note of these two lines. Take courage and do not be afraid. These two lines are synonymous. They convey the same idea. Take courage. Do not be afraid. They're saying the same thing, actually. So if you observe this chiastic structure, these two things, the one above and the one below, they are saying the same thing. And the emphasis here on this statement, the whole statement of the Lord, take courage, it is I, do not be afraid, is the one that is in the middle when he said, it is I. What is the significance of this line? It is I. Take courage, do not be afraid, it is I. The Lord is telling his disciples, I know that you are tired. I know that you are physically exhausted. I know that you are worried. I know that you are anxious. I know that you are struggling. But in the midst of all these things, it is I. I am here in your midst. I am here. My presence is with you. And that is the game changer of all situations in life. when they realized that the presence of their master is in their midst, that erased every worry that they had. That removed the anxiety that they felt. That removed the fatigue that they were having, because there the master is already in the midst of these situations that they were in. My friends, I believe this crisis that we are facing today has left us worrying. It made us anxious from time to time. We imagine what's going to happen to me. It makes us feel worried about tomorrow. Will there be a better tomorrow? What will happen in the week to come? Will the quarantine be extended again? What will happen to me next month? Will my plan still pursue? We worry, we are anxious, we are tired, we are frustrated. But in the midst of all this situation, Jesus is offering the same statement for you and for me. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. And the emphasis on that line, as I have mentioned earlier, is it is I. The Lord is telling you and me that He is in our midst. And when He is there, everything will be in a different sense from the perspective of the presence of the Almighty One. Whatever you are going through in your respective homes today, whatever that comes into your mind during the night before going to sleep that makes you worried and anxious about life, I tell you, when you realize that your master is there in your midst, that makes everything so different. And it is my desire and prayer that you and I would learn to listen to the voice of our master when he tells us, it is I. I am here. Take courage. Do not be afraid. Listen to that statement of the Lord. Because oftentimes, we listen to the statements of the circumstances. You know what? Whatever the Lord would say to us, if we keep on listening to the dictation of the circumstances around us, the words of the Lord would not affect us. If the disciples chose to listen the struggles brought by the wind, if the disciples chose to listen to the complaint of their physical body, if the disciples chose to listen to the complaint of their being in their minds and in their hearts, why did he not go to us when he said, I'll follow you? If they listened to those voices, their frustrations wouldn't be removed. Their anxiety will not cease. Their worry will always be there. But if they chose to listen to the words of their master, I am here. Take courage. Do not be afraid. It is I. Choose to listen to the words of Jesus. Maybe you have been hearing news through your television. Maybe you would have been reading bad news through your Facebook wall, your Twitter, your Instagram. And those things would make you worry. Yes, we are overwhelmed by those many information that we receive affect us, an effect of this coronavirus. But I tell you, if you choose to listen to the voice of Jesus, it will make things so different. And the same words he offers to all of us today, take courage, do not be afraid. Jesus is in our midst. God bless you and a blessed Sunday to all.
Lord, it's been so good that He allowed us to realize and be reminded that He's the only voice that we should listen to. The voice that is sweet and calm, that still small voice says, do not be afraid. Though the situation are scary, but that voice tells you not to be afraid, for He is with us. Thank you.
voices out there, this virus that interrupted us is saying, you will die. But the voice of truth, the voice of God, the voice of the Word of God is telling us we will survive. You listen to the news, you will see the problem. And maybe the message that will be conveyed to everyone is, you will all be destroyed. But the voice of truth is saying, do not be afraid. I am with you. Things that are happening around may say and tell you, you cannot make it. But the voice of truth will say, my presence in your life will be enough. If you look at the situation, maybe you will hear a voice that says, you don't have enough medical facilities. You don't have the vaccine. You don't have the cure. But the voice of truth will give us the idea that God is at work. And we are in the process of healing. Lord, thank you. Thank you for interruptions in life that would make us know you in a better sense. Yes, this interruption that we are going through right now is ginormous. It's powerful because it's unseen. But we would like to listen to your voice. For you are telling every one of us, you will make it. Yes, you can. You will survive because I am with you. May we continue to live this life for your glory and honor, because you are there taking care of us. And we will be confident to face tomorrow because you are always there. And so we entrust to you every one of us. We entrust to you, Lord God, even our different situation, our difficult situation. May your provision be upon us. May your healing grace be experienced by your children. May your leading and guidance, and may your knowledge and wisdom be upon our scientists, our doctors, our technology, medical technologies, our nurses, and those individuals who will be formulating the vaccine or the cure for this problem. For we know and believe that you are at work and bestowing wisdom to your people. So we entrust to you our whole life, our family, for we are in good hands when we are with you. Thank you. We bless your name in the name of Jesus, and everybody will say to God, amen and amen. To God be all the glory, and happy Sunday to all.